What if false beliefs make us happy? We all know that sometimes the truth can be unsettling, or hurtful, or disturbing. So, does that mean that we should prefer to believe in some comfortable falsehood if it makes us feel better? I want to make a plea for the truth today, for the cold and unvarnished truth. I want to try to persuade you that no matter what, truth is always better. Now, of course, I know that in a lot of respects, you already believe this. We care a lot about truth. For example, we are very much upset about the spread of fake news, about the popularity of conspiracy theories. We balk at the notion of alternative facts, because of course, we realize that there's only one truth. And we can be disturbed when politicians, for example, try to tell us blatant lies. The word post-truth was even voted word of the year by Oxford Dictionaries. And this shows that many people want to restore the value of truth to its rightful place in society, which of course is a good thing. And I applaud that. But do we really cherish the truth in our everyday lives? Or are we living in our own post-truth worlds and our own post-truth universe? Sometimes when I give talks about this topic, I do a little survey by way of show of hands. I'm not going to do it today because the surprising thing about this is that regardless of the age and background of the audience, I always get more or less the same results, so it's pretty predictable. So I present this dilemma to people. Do you think that we all need illusions to go by, that we all need illusions in life to be happy? Or do you think that the truth is always better, no matter what? And as it turns out, a comfortable majority of people, though not an overwhelming majority, thinks that we all need illusions to go by, that in order to be happy, all of us need some sort of small, little follies to sugarcoat reality, because in its full weight, reality is just unbearable. People have this kind of pragmatic attitude about truth. Of course, they say true beliefs are often useful to accomplish goals in life. But why do you have to be so insistent upon the truth? I mean, what's so great about reality anyway? And also, if it is true that the truth can sometimes hurt, why should we want to expose the illusions of other people? Why should we want to spoil it for them? This is a matter of personal interest to me because I've been involved in the skeptics movement here in Flanders. Skeptics investigate all sorts of irrational and weird beliefs, pseudoscience, conspiracy theories, etc. And I've even written a book about this with my supervisor, where we play the role of the doubting Thomas, and we demand evidence for all sorts of beliefs. And every time we arrive at the conclusion that there really isn't any good scientific evidence for all these beliefs. And I listed a couple of them: creationism, telepathy, conspiracy theories, homeopathy, belief in the afterlife. Now, even if we are right that these beliefs are irrational, I mean, shouldn't it give us pause that perhaps these illusions were actually beneficial for people? And if this is true, wasn't it some sort of a reckless and wanton act on our part to take away these illusions for people? Were we some sort of party poopers? Well, I did a little bit of soul-searching after realizing this, that perhaps we had caused harm by just dispelling the illusions of people. And I took comfort in the wisdom of the playwright George Bernard Shaw, who wrote that the fact that a believer is happier than a skeptic is no more to the point than the fact that a drunken man is happier than a sober one. Phew! Well, that's all, folks. We can all go home now. everything is it's fine, so I shouldn't have to worry about having dispelled other people's beliefs. Well, okay, let's not be over hasty. We could, of course, make this shortcut, but I think it's a little bit too easy. I think, of course, it is relevant that drunken people are happy. It's just that this is not the only thing that we should take into account when we talk about alcohol. We know that alcohol has both benefits and downsides. Or, as the great philosopher Homer Simpson once put it, to alcohol, the cause of and solution to all of life's problems. Now, I think we should apply the same sort of utility calculus to positive illusions as well, to beneficial misbeliefs. So, is the truth always better? And you can construe the word truth here in the broadest possible sense. So this can be the truth about the fact that the universe is expanding and that everything will go to smithereens, or that we're all mortal and that we're all going to die at some point. Or very homely personal truths about our individual lives. Now, if you ask people, the group of people who are convinced that we all need some sort of illusions to survive and to be happy, if you ask them what sorts of beliefs might be beneficial for people, even though they are false, well, these are the sorts of things that they come up with. Believe in God might alleviate our existential anxieties, let's say. Or what about believe in reincarnation? Perhaps it works even better than believe in the ordinary afterlife. Or, for that matter, believe in a communist utopia. Perhaps that might make us happy as well. Or it might be beneficial to society. Not sure about that. Believe in homeopathy. It may be completely pseudoscientific and false, but perhaps you can benefit from the placebo effect if you believe that it works. Or believe in yourself. So-called positive illusions. And actually, I'm going to focus a little bit on those positive illusions because I think that they make for the best and most likely candidate for the thing that we're looking for, namely beneficial illusions. There's actually some good, solid scientific evidence backing up the claim that positive illusions are beneficial. Psychologists have found that all of us are susceptible to self-enhancement. We all overestimate our own skills and talents. Up to 90% of people, for example, think that they are better drivers than average. In my own field, at the university, it's even worse. A full 94% of professors think that they are better teachers than their average colleague. And to top it all, a full quarter of the population thinks that when it comes to social skills, they belong up there in the top 1%. Everyone is above average. Isn't that great? Of course, it's also statistically very improbable. Well, I don't doubt that these beliefs make you feel happy. I mean, who wouldn't want to believe that you're smarter and funnier and more talented than the average person, and modest besides? The problem, of course, is that beliefs are not innocuous. They have consequences. They ramify in our worldview, and they can have downstream effects. And these effects may be unexpected. In unforeseen ways, your false beliefs about reality might collide with the world sooner or later. Now, applied to positive illusions, if self-esteem came in a bottle, it should probably carry this sort of warning. Guaranteed to make you feel better. Caution, unexpected side effects may occur. Now, here's a question. Have you ever texted while driving? You don't have to confess it. You just have to ponder the question for a little while. Well, if you have done so, it might be because of overconfidence. As it turns out, and this is true scientific fact, people who are overconfident about their driving skills, remember the 90% of people from back a minute ago, they take greater risks For example, they will text while driving, or they will even drive under influence because they think, well, this would be a problem for a lesser driver, but of course, I can handle this, no problem at all. This might bring your own life in danger and also the life of other people. One of the most impressive examples of the havoc that positive illusions can wreak is the First World War. At the eve of the First World War in 1914, nobody was expecting a world war. Everyone was convinced that the war would be over in a matter of weeks. Everyone would be home by Christmas. And of course, everyone was convinced that they were going to win. There was this very complacent belief in the superiority of each nation and country. Of course, the result was the terrible trench warfare that is now written in our history books. Overconfident CEOs make worse deals, as it turns out, and actually lower the stock value of their company. So if you're in a company and your CEO is elected CEO of the year, be careful, because that's the moment where things will start to get downhill, because then the CEO will really develop an oversized ego. The financial crisis, to a large extent, was caused by positive illusions, by this false sense of security that these financial experts had lulled us into, this idea that you shouldn't worry about anything, all the risks are under control because we have sophisticated mathematical tools, etc. Don't worry. And of course, the king of self-confidence, the one who trumps everyone else when it comes to inflated self-esteem, is the guy who heralded the post-truth era in the first place, Donald Trump. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not against positive thinking. I'm not against setting your mind on a positive outcome and making the best out of life. Of course, I'm also not against optimism. I wouldn't be standing here to give a TED talk if I were against optimism. I think sometimes there are very good and rational reasons to be optimistic. And I think that positive illusions, so-called positive illusions, might actually hamper our success. So not only can we do without false beliefs, but false beliefs can actually be harmful. So to conclude, I do think that the truth is always better, because illusions are potentially dangerous. Even though they may seem innocuous at first, sooner or later they can collide with reality. Positive illusions, of course, feel nice. I mean, who wouldn't want to have the self-esteem of Donald Trump? I mean, of course it must feel great. But inevitably, they will lead to disappointment sooner or later. Because reality doesn't care a damn about our wishes and desires and illusions. Even worse, positive illusions might inspire reckless sorts, kinds of behavior. So I do think that truth is your best friend, and I can't put it any better than in the words of Gloria Steinem, who said, "The truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off." Thank you.